what does it mean to be a one-hit wonder? Well, it's pretty straightforward. You have a huge hit, and that's that. You probably continue making recordings, but none of them reach the success of your breakout song. And that can be bittersweet. Some artists are able to continue making hits, while others fade into obscurity, never being remembered as much as their one big song. But that's just one way to define success. And it's just one perspective. Songs that are hits in certain countries might not even chart in others. And someone who's known as a one-hit wonder in the US might have a completely different legacy and career in another country. But let's switch focus and go to Germany. Because on February 22nd, 1969, the German broadcasting station ARD hosted a competition in Frankfurt to see who would represent the country in that year's Eurovision. And among the contestants was Peggy March, a 21-year-old from Pennsylvania. It wasn't unusual for someone not from Germany to represent the country in Eurovision, but Peggy was the first person from the US to try. And at the time, Peggy was mainly known as a one-hit wonder in the US. But outside of the country, she was so, so much more. I know I'll always love him. All right, so would you be able to tell me just a bit about your upbringing, like in the Italian, Dutch, Pennsylvanian family in which you grew up? Like, yeah.
I grew up in a very small town, 15,000 people. Now it's, of course, it's a suburb of Philadelphia, so people go in and out of Lansdale, PA, all the time. A huge family, not my direct family, but my parents come from a big family, 7 and 9 kids. So there were cousins all around all the time. I was the only one who sang. My father was not crazy about it, although as long as Mom saw that I enjoyed it, he was okay with it. And that's pretty much it until I was discovered at a wedding reception. I was 13 at the time. He approached my father and said, I think your daughter would have a great career and I'd like to take her under my wing and I'd like to get a label. And I don't know what he promised Dad, but Dad said absolutely not.
After she was able to convince her father to let her take the opportunity, Peggy was taken under her new manager Russell Smith's wing and eventually nabbed an audition for the producers Hugo and Luigi, who had just come off the heels of The Lion Sleeps Tonight, a number one hit recorded by The Tokens in 1961. Hugo and Luigi were also known for their affiliation with RCA Victor Records, the label that would eventually put out Peggy's first recording. It was with Hugo and Luigi that she would get the name Little Peggy March for two reasons. She was only 4 feet 10 inches tall, and she was born in March. This also coincided with the opportunity to record her first single, Little Me. Originally a duo from the Broadway show of the same name, the song was fashioned into a pop song that featured Peggy singing in front of a men's chorus. Little Me was released on November 6, 1962, and though it was a huge milestone for Peggy as a 14-year-old who just released a song on RCA, the record didn't do well and didn't even make it onto the Billboard Top 100. However, Little Me was an important stepping stone to her next recording, I Will Follow Him. Originally a popular instrumental called Chariot by Frank Purcell and Paul Marriat that found success with French lyrics via a recording by Petula Clark, the song would get its name from new English lyrics by Norm Gimbel and Arthur Altman. The song would land on the desk of Peggy's producers, Hugo and Luigi, who then gave her the song to take home and practice. And at the time, she didn't think much of it. In January of 1963, she went to New York to record it, and the song was released on January 22nd. This is where Peggy's career really began to take off. I Will Follow Him entered the Billboard charts at 90 on the week of March 23rd, and within a month it would hit the number one spot where it remained for 3 straight weeks. And to this day, Peggy March is still the youngest woman to have a number one hit on the Billboard charts, having recorded the song while she was a freshman at Lansdale Catholic High School.
It was just something that happened to me, yeah. And it was a progression of things. I sang as a kid, I sang as a teenager, and I'm still doing it. It's kind of, okay, this is cool. This is really cool. It never dawned on me my age thing until much later, when I wasn't allowed to perform in clubs in New York because I was still a minor. I had had a hit record at the age of 14. By the time I went to number one, I had turned 15. It never dawned on me that you're not going to be old enough to do clubs.
So what made this song such a hit? Like with all successful pop songs, it's difficult to say with certainty, but the song was definitely a combination of many intersections in US American pop music of the time. Like I said, the song had already been popular with audiences of what we might label now as 50s easy listening music. The Petula Clark had a similar vibe, using more elements of blues music, but it was still very tied to musical trends that had been more popular in the 40s and 50s. In contrast, the Little Peggy March version took this easy listening foundation and turned it into a song that sounded very modern. Conducted by Sammy Lowe, the arrangement fits in well with trends of the early 1960s. It's loud, dense, and features many instruments, almost mimicking Phil Spector's trademark wall of sound style. There are doo-wop background vocals, and Peggy's voice is recorded multiple times over, something that didn't happen on the Petula Clark recording. Her voice is also loud. She's shouting to declare her love for someone. These subtle differences are important to note because they show Peggy's developing versatility as an artist. With her previous recordings, she showed how she could sing and blend in with many different genres of US American pop music of the time. With I Will Follow Him, she proved that she was ready to join the hit parade. And that's just what she did. I Will Follow Him not only skyrocketed Little Peggy March to pop star status, but it also made her an international pop star. The song hit number one in many countries, including Australia, Canada, and Uruguay. It also reached number 6 on the German charts, and its success resulted in performances in Japan, Berlin, and even an appearance on Caterina Valente's TV show. In May of 1963, she released another single called I Wish I Were a Princess, with the B-side My Teenage Castle is Tumbling Down. This was once again produced by Hugo and Luigi and conducted by Sammy Lowe. The arrangement also featured similar elements to I Will Follow Him, such as the deep doo-wop-esque voices that hold down the rhythm. The song didn't do as well, but it was another notch in the belt of Peggy's developing career. She continued recording songs and released her first full album later that year. But for some people, this is all they know about her career. Her early songs renewed in popularity in the 80s and 90s when they were featured in movies like Sister Act and Hairspray, and they were still thought of as important parts of pop music history, but to this day in the US, many people don't know many of the albums she's released in the decades since her breakout hit. In other words, many people still think of her as a one-hit wonder. Though she was internationally renowned for I Will Follow Him, her following albums didn't have as much of an impact on the US charts. But Peggy's career wasn't bound to the Billboard charts, and it certainly wasn't bound to US culture or even the English language. In fact, over her career, she's recorded in 7 different languages, and has become a pop star in multiple countries. And as you can see, Peggy March's career was just getting started. In 1964, she released her first non-English album, an album in Italian that she did with Ennio Morricone. How was that? Because you were also learning so many languages, how to sing in so many languages from such a young age. And so what was that like being in a room full of other people? Were they making decisions for you? Were you making decisions in conjunction?
Yes.
How was that? How did they decide, oh, you're going to go do this album in Spanish or something?
Pretty much. That's exactly what happened. I was 13. I was 14. I was 15. So everything was basically given to me. Mm-hmm. I rarely had a choice in anything I sang. Mm-hmm. Rarely. So I went in there, stood in front of a microphone, and did my thing. Mm-hmm. Having no idea, I never ever reflected, wow, you're really pretty young to do this. I don't think I ever went there. I was naive. I was thankful for the fact that I got the chance to do this, but it wasn't really a matter of, wow, do you realize that at this age nobody's ever done this kind of thing before? It never occurred to me. I still had a Latin test the next day or an English test the next day, so I had to prepare for that as well. And it was kind of weird, but this is what it was. And Europe happened because RCA was an international label. It was one of the biggest, of course, too, at the time. And it sent a lot of its artists to various countries like Japan and Germany and Spain and whatever. And I had a very good ear. I also had very good teachers who were relatively patient with me so that I would get the exact pronunciations of some words. And again, it was fun. I enjoyed this. The kids at school didn't get it, and that was okay that they didn't get it. I was away a lot of the time. And so I didn't know who Susie went out with, you know, Charlie, whatever. I never got that because I was somewhere else. I was somewhere else in the world. And it was okay with me. It really was okay with me because I was lucky to be doing what I loved.
Unlike pop contemporaries who sang in other languages just to broaden their audience, Peggy March was becoming a truly international pop star who developed her artistry in the languages she sang. This was made even more apparent with her 1965 album Tagebuch einer 17-Jährigen that was her first album in German. When singing German, Peggy wasn't just a US American trying out a new language. She was becoming an artist in Germany, and that's an important distinction to make. Of course, she continued releasing music in English. In 1965 alone, she released two more albums. However, her next big break would come in the form of Mit 17 hat man noch Träume, a song written by Heinz Korn that catapulted her to pop star status in Germany, even staying in the top 10 for 3 months. The song paints a beautiful picture of what it can feel like to be an optimistic teenager, still having the freedom and courage to dream. Peggy performed the song at the 1965 German Schlager contest and won the competition by a landslide, making it clear that she was becoming a major voice in the German music scene. But you might be wondering, what's Schlager? For many US Americans, the word is completely unfamiliar, and perhaps that also plays a role in why many in the US don't know about Peggy's international career. Put simply, Schlager is a type of European pop music that literally means hits. The definition of the genre depends on who you ask, but it's often referenced as something involving a beat and sentimental lyrics. The beat isn't always as important, though. Plenty of ballads are also considered Schlager. The most fitting analogy is probably American country music. Both Schlager and country are genres that are sometimes linked to national identity and are less defined by the music and more so the context and the content they talk about. They also have both changed a great deal with societal pop trends. While Schlager today is mostly comprised of dancey pop music that many US Americans know from Eurovision, the genre intersected much more with cabaret in the early 20th century. This is similar to country music, that has also changed a great deal over the past 100 years. So, when I talk about Peggy March being a pop star in Germany, I mean that she's a Schlager star. Though there have been some artists in English language markets that resemble Schlager, such as Engelbert Humperdinck, for the most part, the genre is unknown in the US. After winning the German Schlager contest, it was clear that Peggy had a blossoming career on her hands. But despite being an international pop star, she was still a high schooler in Lansdale, Pennsylvania. Because of her busy schedule, though, she was forced to transfer from Lansdale Catholic High School to a private school. Put simply, she didn't attend classes enough to fulfill the legal requirement for public school. Finishing up high school and turning 18 meant many things for Peggy, but most importantly, it was an opportunity to take more control over her career. As a child star, she was bound to the Coogan Act, a bill designed to prevent the exploitation of minors by safeguarding the money they made. It was named after Jackie Coogan, whose parents had spent his fortune before he reached adulthood. When Peggy was starting out, this meant that her parents were not able to manage her finances, and therefore her manager Russell Smith was brought in to do so. However, when she turned 18, Peggy quickly found out that Smith had squandered her fortune, leaving her with only $500, which is a little over $4,000 today when adjusted for inflation. And when you consider that she was a pop star who was traveling the world for her career, $500 was a devastating amount. But she kept going. Peggy continued to record and perform in the late 60s, developing her artistry in multiple languages. By this point, she also had a following in Japan, having toured and released multiple songs in Japanese. Germany is the place where Peggy has had the most success throughout her career, but her following in Japan is a close second. Peggy's 1969 song Wasure Nai wa is still considered a pop classic in the country and has been covered by many artists. Though she didn't have as much commercial success as she once did in the US, she was quickly becoming a household name in Germany. But Peggy wasn't the only US American who had a presence in Schlager. For example, Connie Francis had recorded in German before her, the singer Gus Backus was also becoming popular in the German market, and even Elvis Presley sang in German. Peggy was different, though. Instead of occupying the role of a token American singing German pop music, she was becoming a bona fide German pop star. She was losing her American accent and was having more hits in Germany than she had in the US. Songs like Memories of Heidelberg hint to her US American origins through her pronunciation of the brief English lyric in the song's chorus. This had become a signature of her style, singing songs in German but having an English hook or lyric nestled within a song. Memories of Heidelberg sind memories of you. Und von dieser schönen Zeit, da träum ich immer zu. Memories of Heidelberg would eventually reach number 5 on the German charts in 1969, and it would stay on the charts for 21 weeks. In 1967, she also had what is probably her biggest hit in Germany, the song Romeo und Julia. Written by Hans Bratke and Henry Meyer, the song riffs off of Shakespeare's Romeo and Juliet to paint a hopeful picture of a budding romance. The song skyrocketed to the top of the German charts and stayed in the top 10 for 12 weeks out of its 22-week run. The song was also translated and recorded by singers in other languages, and did well in countries like Sweden, France, and more, which is a unique example of one of Peggy's German language hits having international success. The song also brought with it a unique record. By singing it on the Galaabend der Schallplatte, the 25th German radio show, Peggy actually became the first person to perform on color TV in the country. For many people, Peggy March was no longer a US-American who was making international appearances. She was an artist in multiple languages and cultures. But back in the US, the pop scene was a bit different. While Peggy continued releasing music in English, the British invasion and the rise of rock music were taking over the American market. And with political tensions regarding the civil rights movement, the Vietnam War, and the rising counterculture of the time, the aesthetic of mainstream pop music was shifting away from what it was when her career began. So she shifted with it. While she was making Schlager in Germany, she was also recording music that fit the US-American scene. The 1967 song Your Good Girl's Gonna Go Bad is a notable example of this, with an energetic arrangement by Bill McElhiney that embraced a more rock and roll sound. '67 was also the year that Peggy met the love of her life. After celebrating her 19th birthday at RCA, she met with Arnie Harris, the man who would become her manager and husband. They moved to Munich together in 1969, where they'd reside till the early 80s. Which brings us back to 1969, the year that Peggy took part in the ARD contest to represent Germany in Eurovision. Though she didn't win the competition, at this point in her career she had already accomplished an impressive feat. At the age of 21, she had a fruitful career as a pop star around the world and could sing in 7 different languages. Even if some people in the US still thought of her as Little Peggy March, it was clear that she had truly moved into a new era, one where she was a star in her own right and on her own terms. And conversely, a lot of people in Germany didn't know that she was even from the US. When I began working on this video, I told a few German friends and colleagues about it, only to find out that none of them even knew that she's from the States. I found that really interesting, because like I said, though Peggy's accent became non-existent while singing in German, a number of her songs sprinkled in English lyrics or refrains. So in the early 70s, Peggy's career was occupying an interesting space. The German music scene forgot where she came from, while her home country, the US, had basically forgotten her music outside of her breakout hit. But Peggy didn't forget the US. Even while she was off being a pop star in Germany, she still kept ties to the States. A notable example is from the Peggy in Berlin TV special from 1970. The sequence of all German language songs is abruptly interrupted by Otis Redding sitting on the dock at the bay, showing that Peggy was still in touch with the music scene back home even while she was abroad.
Sitting on the dock of the bay, watching the tide roll away.
Like I was talking about earlier, when you were doing all this stuff in Germany, the US music scene was so tumultuous and it was so in flux. So it's interesting to see like Otis Redding make an appearance right. in the Berlin special. So how did that come about? Was that your idea?
Well, the point is that I was not always, and I put this in quotes, allowed to sing in English.
Uh-huh.
Because once I established myself, if you will, as a German artist, there are a lot of producers, radio and television and so on, who would let me. And so I really wanted a couple of songs to be in English, and one of them was On the Dock of the Bay. And I loved where they put me. They put me on this dock, this mm-hmm. train ride and the docks, and of course Berlin is considered the Venice of Germany. It mm-hmm. has these canals everywhere. And it was such a pretty spot. And we had to do it like in 2 takes because it was the sun was going down. But the lighting was just exceptional. I was allowed to wear jeans and I had, I think, sneakers on. It was like, oh, I love this. This is just too cool. And so mm-hmm. I was really happy with that one. But it was one of the few English songs that I was allowed to do at that time.
Mm-hmm.
That's why. And Otis Redding, yeah. This particular song, I just always loved it. So.
Mm-hmm. Throughout the 70s, Peggy continued to record and perform while also raising her daughter, Sandy. She remained an important figure in Schlager music and worked the most in Germany during these years. From 1963 to 1977 alone, she had 28 songs hit the German top 50, 5 of which broke the top 10. However, she also continued releasing music in other countries where she had worked previously. A great example of this is the 1971 album Love Story that was released in Japan and features a remarkable performance of Joni Mitchell's Both Sides Now accompanied by the Denon Orchestra. On the recording, Peggy's voice floats above the orchestra, with the arrangement switching effortlessly between references to the Judy Collins rendition before slowly morphing into a big band jazz finish that positions March as a confident crooner. And all of this is being done while she's also communicating the subtle heartbreak of the lyrics.
Moons and dunes and fairs with the dizzy dancing way you feel.
1978's Fly Away Pretty Flamingo is a unique album in the context of Peggy's discography. It shows off multiple aspects of her artistic personality on just one album. For example, a majority of the songs are in German, but many of them have choruses that are sung in English. And though it might seem like it, not all of these songs are translations. For example, the title track Fly Away Pretty Flamingo is an original song with half English, half German lyrics that ended up being a huge hit for Peggy. This is my personal favorite Peggy album, but there's one song on it that I don't think is talked about enough in Peggy's discography, Oklahoma Bay. With lyrics by John Möhring and music by Detlef Reshöft and Reinhard Franz, the song finds Peggy reminiscing about the titular Oklahoma Bay, where she feels at peace. It's not only a song with great vocals and production, but I think the lyrics are so interesting. It's set in the US state of Oklahoma, but it's mostly sung in German, something that I think represents Peggy's career well, being in between cultures. Oklahoma Bay, Oklahoma Bay, Oklahoma Bay. It's songs like this that remind me just how unique of an artist Peggy March is. Unlike many of her contemporaries, Peggy March was able to operate within so many different types of music from what feels like an earnest standpoint. In pop music, it's so easy to change with trends in a way that feels artificial or performative. Each new language or style of music can feel like a costume if one treats it that way. However, with Peggy March, it doesn't feel that way. She collaborates with different musicians and composers in different contexts, but it all sounds like Peggy March. And that's why you can have albums like Fly Away Pretty Flamingo that have songs in both German and English, and seem to contain a lifetime's worth of experience, emotion, and musicality. After releasing a disco album called Electrifying in 1979, Peggy and her family left Germany for the United States in 1980, specifically moving to Los Angeles, California. In the 80s, she also found success writing her own songs. In 1983, she formed the short-lived band BMW with Michael Bradley and Steve Whitmack, resulting in them co-writing When the Rain Begins to Fall, a song that became a hit for Jermaine Jackson and Pia Zadora. Though Peggy was not singing, she once again had a song on the US Billboard charts. It peaked at 54 on the Hot 100 and at 22 on Dance Club Songs, but it became a number one hit in many European countries. Throughout the 80s, Peggy continued working with labels to release compilations, singles, and even an album of children's songs that she wrote herself. This was also when the early part of her career started to have a comeback. Like I mentioned earlier, in the late 80s and early 90s in the US, nostalgia for music from the 60s resulted in multiple references to Peggy and her early work in movies like Sister Act and Hairspray. Her music has also appeared in more recent media, such as Orange is the New Black, which featured I Wish I Were a Princess. Germany also saw a resurgence of nostalgia in the 90s, but it was for Schlager. The Schlager revival of the 90s resulted in a renewed interest in Peggy's career, and the compilations and singles kept coming. She also appeared on many TV shows during this period, mostly in German-speaking countries, but she continued to work in other places as well. Peggy's musical influence extended beyond her own recordings. Multiple generations of people have grown up listening to her music. In particular, the singer-songwriter and actor Andreas Zajon was a huge fan of Peggy, and the two would eventually become friends, with Peggy and her husband Arnie mentoring Zajon as he navigated the music industry and wrote his own music. To this day, Zajon is the primary archivist for Peggy's career, having documented it in great detail. And they've collaborated on music, a notable example being their version of When the Rain Begins to Fall. The 2000s saw Peggy March step back into the limelight, this time in English. The 2005 album Get Happy features a majority of songs in English, showing her take on selections from the Great American Songbook and other jazz standards. She also moved to Florida, where she still lives today. In 2010, she released Always and Forever, an album filled almost entirely with songs she wrote in collaboration with Sören Jensen. The album itself is emotional, mixing intimate and personal lyrics with energizing rhythms and harmonies. For an artist who's been recording Schlager since the 60s, Always and Forever is a bold and distinctly modern evolution of her musical style. The production by Sören Jensen is wonderfully polished, and leaves plenty of room for Peggy's voice to project throughout the album. And the song I Can't Say No to You is one of the finest songs in Peggy's discography, and it's also notable for having lyrics that she wrote herself. What starts out as a solemn choral intro breaks out into an infectious dance number, leading to the simple but earnest declaration that Peggy can't say no to her love. Her husband Arnie would pass away about 2.5 years after Always and Forever was released. His passing was a sad loss, and since then, Peggy's been pretty open about the love she still has for him. And this album sounds like a unique testament to that. Not every song on the album is specifically about Peggy's life, but she has said that the title track was dedicated to her husband. So when I listen to the album, I can't help but think about that context. When Always and Forever was released, I was attending high school in Connecticut. It would be years before I moved to Berlin and was introduced to Schlager for the first time. At first, I didn't quite know what to think. I was vaguely familiar with Europop music, but Schlager felt so different than anything I had heard before. Learning about its unique and nuanced history was exciting, and when I stumbled upon memories of Heidelberg, I couldn't stop listening to it. It wasn't even a few weeks later, while watching the music video, that I made the connection. That's Peggy March. Because, like I said, Schlager as a genre is virtually unknown in modern US American culture. And for someone like Peggy March, who had a very strong start in the States before working a lot in other countries, many people have mislabeled her as a one-hit wonder or just a child star from the 60s. I grew up listening to her early music, but was not aware of just how vast and prolific her career has been. Learning about and listening to her recordings over the last few years has been an incredibly rewarding experience, but ultimately it's had me continually asking myself one question. Why didn't I know about this? I think there are many reasons. There are international hits in mainstream US pop culture, but they're certainly not as common as the local music scenes that get coverage. And due to the British invasion and the general tumultuous political and musical scenes of the 60s, many US American performers who went abroad got lost in the cracks of how we think about music history in the 20th century. But Peggy March doesn't seem to care about that. She's built a career that isn't bound to a single country or language. And she's still going. She released a new album in 2019, a single last year, a single this year, and she has more music on the way. A while back, I went to Hamburg to visit Peggy while she was in Germany doing some recordings and TV show appearances. Though the first time we met, I filmed a lot for interview things, this time I just wanted to talk without any pressure to be on the spot. And I will admit that there were moments over the 4 hours that we talked in which I wish I had been recording. But at the same time, it was good to just turn off the cameras and the microphones and just sit and listen as Peggy talked to me about her life and music. One story that Peggy told me has stuck with me. When she was a teenager, she was brought a certain song to sing, but she didn't do it. It was about looking at the world in a very big picture way, and she thought that she was just too young and didn't have enough experience yet to sing about something like that. So she turned it down, and it was given to Louis Armstrong. What a Wonderful World ended up being one of Armstrong's biggest hits, and it's still an enduring classic in pop music history. But Peggy was probably right. Maybe the song would have been completely different if she had sung it as a teenager back in the 60s. Since then, though, she's been through so much and has learned a lot, from languages to songs to love and loss. And throughout her life, one thing has always been certain. She's anything but a one-hit wonder. 1, 2, 3.